Thank you very much.
Okay, so I got interested in the question of computational complexity recently,
something most people will know a lot about. So I've got a little bit of revision about computational complexity in this course, in this talk here. And then after that, some explanation of why it's not really enough to go on anymore. The background to this title slide is taken from a book I'm going to be talking about a bit during the today. Don Knuth's Art of Computer Programming. Very brief introduction about myself. If you know of me in the Java world at all, it's because I'm co-author of this book on Java generics and collections. I wrote the collections part. So this, and it's actually the collections part of this book that, though it's quite an old book now, it was written for Java 5, forms the background of this talk. One of the good things about having written a couple of books, I've also written this one as well, is that about Java 8, is that if you write, once you've written a couple of books, you can then go around doing a lot of talks subsequently, talking about all the things you got wrong, and apologising for them and trying to put them right. So that's one of the things I'm going to be doing today. I do a similar kind of thing for the Java 8 book, where I really misunderstood the potential of multi-core parallelism. But I'm not going to talk about that today. I'm going to talk instead about the complexity that I emphasise in the collections chapter of the Java Generics and Collections. Okay, so some more stuff about me, a Java champion and Java 1 rock star. So I talk about not your father's complexity, so good question as well. Right. Who is your father then? Well, I don't mean biologically, despite what we saw in the previous talk. So one possible candidate for your father in terms of your father's complexity is this guy. So Don Knuth, a great name in the field of computing science, creator of tech and Turing Award laureate and a lot of other stuff as well. Very, very well known. And more than anything, the author of The Art of Computer Programming, which he almost single-handedly invented what became for years standard way of measuring the performance, or rather analysing the performance of computer programs. One of the things that's most impressive about Don Knuth, I mean, there are many things that are very impressive about him. One of them is his wisdom. I take as an example of how wise he is that, I mean, he's definitely not going to be involved in social media, but actually, after 15 years of using email, he gave that up as well. He was wise enough to say that, well, his idea was that email, he said, was very good for people who want to keep on top of things, but I'm a person who wants to get to the bottom of things. So, yes. It's funny that he should be identified with this computational complexity, which is something which is an idea that's used obviously for talking about the performance of programs, because he actually gave a very good warning about worrying too much about performance. And this is something I always have to do. I talk a lot about performance these days, although really I don't think I should do. So Knuth said that we should forget about small efficiencies at, say, about 97% of the time. Premature optimization is the root of all evil. And of course everybody knows this, but in spite of that, everybody's really interested in performance, even though most of the time, for most people, it's actually, for most programmers, most of the time, it's not really very important. But when it is important, it's important. So what's the computational complexity that he didn't invent, but that he popularised? Well, the idea of it is that if you've got an algorithm with time complexity that you calculate as order of f of n, so big O is the big O notation's the key to this, it'll complete in less than some multiplication of some other function of steps for some m and sufficiently large n. So we've got a picture of something like this, which I think is taken from Wikipedia, and f of n is the actual time that the algorithm is going to take to execute, and cg of n is the bounding function. So it basically gives you an upper bound on how long an algorithm is going to take to execute. So for one example, the only one you'll see in this talk, Knuth analyzes a multiple list insertion sort, and the execution time of this is 3.5 times n squared plus 24 0.5 times n plus 4, n plus 2, where n is the number of elements in the lists that are being that are being sorted, and m is the number of lists there are. And the point about this formula is that if n gets big, then n squared is going to dwarf all the other terms, and so really the only thing we really care about is the n squared term. So why would we bother with all of this? Well, the reason for bothering with it is it's a traditional way of evaluating the performance of algorithms, because we have these classes of algorithms which everybody knows the first few, I think. So order one is constant, and order log n is for like binary searches and so on. That the best way of understanding these actually is what's in the right-hand column there. What happens if you double the data size for order one? Because the number of steps that the algorithm is going to take to execute stays the same. For order log n, you add a constant. For order n, well, you double it because the length of the number of instructions is proportional to the data size. And for order n log n, well, it's a mixture of those. And for order n squared, well, you multiply by 2 squared, which is 4. And in fact, although there's a huge universe of different complexity classes, and academic computer scientists love to spend a lot of time thinking about all the infinitely, literally infinitely many complexity classes there are, we're really only interested in 4 of them for practical computing problems, which are these 4. Above that, for real-size data sets, algorithms are pretty much infeasible. So what's this got to do with collections, Java collections? Well, another candidate, I always knew about all this stuff, but I didn't really take it, I didn't apply it to anything to do with Java until I came across another candidate for your father's complexity, which is this guy. So Josh Bloch was the author of Effective Java, so very well known in the Java world, and also author of the Java Collections Framework. I was very fortunate when I wrote about collections, I was extremely fortunate, absolutely like winning the pools, to get Josh as a technical reviewer for that section of the book. And he wrote an extremely detailed, and I should say extremely critical review of what I'd written, because it wasn't very good, and he put me right on a whole lot of things in a pretty fierce way. It was a typical comment from Josh about something you've written. He said, I think this is right. I'd write that. And he said, this is totally false and misleading. But in fact, actually, to get constructive criticism from Josh Bloch is gold dust. So one of the things he told me was, I mustn't do things like this, which you can still find on the internet. You can in people's, and actually in textbooks about the collections framework. And the idea of this is you sort of document the collections framework. He says, no, don't tell people about the abstract classes at all. They're not interesting. The diagram you want to show people is this one. You tell them about the interfaces, and you tell them about the implementations of the interfaces, because something that not everybody understands even now about the collections framework 20 years on is that it's an interface-based API, and the idea of it is you choose the interface that you're interested in according to the functionality you want. It's a list or a set or a queue. It kind of breaks down a bit for queues. It breaks down quite a lot for queues. But the principle is you find the interface that meets your requirement, and you choose the implementation with the best performance for your usage scenario, and that's the way in which you select the collection you're going to use. So for example, for lists, basically your choice is linked list or array list, unless you're going to use one of the copy and write array list. But in the original collections framework, those were the possibilities. So which list implementation should you use? Well, in principle, it's supposed to depend on your usage scenario. So if you're going to be adding and removing a lot of elements from the beginning of a list, then an array list is in principle a bad thing to use. Or it's going to not perform so well, because removing or adding elements from the beginning of an array list is order n, because array lists are always zero indexed, and therefore if you remove or add an element from the beginning, you're going to either have to shuffle all the elements up one, or you're going to have to shuffle them all down one. So it looks like that's going to be linear in the size of the data set. So doing that for a large list isn't such a great idea. Whereas for a linked list, all you need to do is just swing a pointer. You're adding a node or you're removing a node from the beginning of the list. So it looks like a linked list would be better for that. For iterating over a list, which is what I'm going to be doing later on, it looks like those are both going to be linear. It's going to be all the work. For an array list, you're going to step through the array list element by element. For a linked list, well, you're going to have to follow a pointer to do it, but hey, it's still going to be, if you double the size of the data, you're going to be doubling the number of instructions. So. Did this ever make sense? Well, yes, it did, actually. I mean, it made a lot of sense on certain assumptions. So the assumptions that it assumed was, first of all, you could ignore constant factors. So you remember that what we were going to say was that the n squared term in that formula I showed you before is going to dominate when n becomes large enough. The point at which n becomes large enough is going to depend on the multiplier for the other factors. If the multiplier for the other factors is really big, then it may be a long time before n squared comes to dominate. a good example of the constant factor there is that business of shuffling the elements up and down the array list. May actually be really, really quick because it's probably you're going to use the intensified operation for moving elements of an array. So that will actually be really efficient, even though it's linear in the number of elements. It also assumes that all instructions have the same duration, because it's really difficult to factor in different instruction times, and they don't all have the same duration. Dividing, floating point divide takes an awful lot longer than integer add. The assumption is that memory doesn't matter, and I'm going to be talking about that quite a lot. There is, of course, there's a computational complexity measure for memory consumption as well, memory footprint, but I'm not going to talk about that. I'm going to talk about a different way in which memory matters. And also, really importantly, that instruction execution actually dominates performance. So the question is, if we increase the number of instructions, we're using instruction execution, or implicitly, if we're going to be interested in this stuff at all, it's because we're interested in performance, and because we think that the number of instructions you execute is a good proxy for the length of time that the computation is going to take. And for a long time, well, let's have a look, was it ever worth it? Well, of course it was. It was great for a while, but instruction execution is only one bottleneck. There are lots of others that can come in: disk or network, garbage collection, resource contention, and more. So the idea of this diagram, which is something everybody's really familiar with, is you may see the bottleneck you've got in the flow of data through your application, and you get rid of that only to reveal another one. That wasn't really worth it, was it? It's a very, very small diagram. Right. That's the point, such as it is. What has happened to make computational complexity less important, or to what other factors are there? Well, the big factor has been trend in computer architecture, or trends in the economics of building computers. Prior to 1980, this is when I learned about computers, I thought I'd learned how computers worked, and I believed that it was never going to change. When I woke up a little while later, like Rip Van Winkle, I discovered the situation changed quite a lot. So prior to 1980, it was really straightforward. You had a control unit and an ALU, and it fetched instructions and data from memory and processed them. And then sent the results. In the case of data, sent the results back to memory. And the idea of this was pretty simple. I couldn't help. I'm afraid I just couldn't help getting distracted when I was writing this talk and looking for images of pre-1980 computers. Here's something that nobody else remembers but me. But this is a thing called a machine hall, and you used to these were cavern-like rooms which stretched way back into the distance and had computers in them. Like would house three or four giant computers with tape decks and, well, you can see the kind of thing. Each one of those computers is probably less powerful than an iPhone nowadays. And I love the way that they advertise what we call mini computers. It always, the adverts always, always had them in a garden. I have no idea why, but you can find lots of them. And they always, always, always had a woman in them. This was the most decent picture of a woman that I could find. But mostly, the women in these adverts didn't have any clothes on at all. Why this is a good way of advertising mini computers, I really don't know. So what's this got to do with anything? Well, what it's got to do with is the fact that at the time that these pictures were taken, memory cost around about $1 per byte. Let's think about it. So the golden age of complexity came as the cost of memory reduced. Look at that. I mean, it went up from a dollar a byte down to, well, what you see, $10 for a gigabyte around about 2010, something like that. So what happened exactly? Well, complexity actually wasn't that important. The kind of computational complexity I've been talking about just now, which is to do with the, how many instructions in memory it takes to execute an algorithm, or how many instructions it takes to execute an algorithm on in-memory data, was dominated prior when memory was so expensive, it was so small, you spent all of your machines typically spent all of the time paging. So you're swapping on and off disks, because disk was sufficiently cheaper to allow you to store relatively large amounts of data. And most realistic algorithms spent all their time doing that. As memory costs came down, we got the golden age of complexity. The memory was cheap enough to execute algorithms in memory, and so at that point, the number of instructions you executed was in fact a reasonable proxy for execution time. So what happened after that? What went wrong? Well, it's an interesting idea of what went wrong, because if we look to see what happened to the performance of memory, it was also going up at the same time. But it was going up by a factor of about 10 in 30 years. It's not such a great improvement. It's not a great improvement when you compare it to what happened to the performance of processors. So this is really the key thing: the gap between the performance of processors and the performance of memory just grew absolutely enormous. What you can see is that processors became around about 1,000 times. They increased in speed by about 1,000 times more than memory. So the question is how to bridge this gap, because the problem now is, and this has been the problem in computer architectures for a quarter of a century at least, is how are you going to get enough data to the processors that work so fast? How are you going to get enough data to them from pretty slow memory over a slow memory bus to keep them running? So keeping the cores running today is a really complicated business, and that's what a huge amount of the energy and the expense, the energy of computer architects and the expense of the chips that they build, that's where it goes. Typically, up to 80% of modern chips are given over to cash. And the whole idea is that what we're going to do is we're going to try and anticipate what the processor is going to use by this hierarchy of caches. The memory hierarchy has an increasing, as you go up this diagram, memory gets more and more expensive, and smaller and smaller, and faster and faster. So you can think of the memory hierarchy all the way out to disk as being a pyramid, really. And as you go higher up in it, the memory gets smaller and cheaper and more expensive and faster. And sometimes I like to use a an analogy for this. I mean, it's kind of childish, but because people aren't that, because the length of time that it takes to retrieve data from memory seems pretty short. I mean, typically around about if we're looking at this the MacBook Pro that I've got here, it's about 2 or 3 gigahertz, so one clock cycle, and the processor is a third of a nanosecond. To retrieve from level 1 cache takes 1 nanosecond, so it's about 3 times as long. To retrieve from level 2 cache is about 4 nanoseconds. So that's about four times as long from level three, about, again, another 16 nanoseconds, about another four times as long, so you're going up by a factor of about three or four each time. And from main memory, about 100 nanoseconds. That still doesn't sound like very long, does it? I like to use an analogy sometimes to sort of bring this back to kind of human understanding. My idea is that you might have somebody, since an operation everybody knows the length of is boiling an egg. So imagine somebody who's standing at a cooker boiling eggs. Each egg is an instruction they have to execute, say a clock cycle, roughly. So it takes three minutes to do that. And they need to have a constant supply of eggs coming in, so they're being passed up. But it's something like, you know, they used to have these bucket brigades putting fire out, people passing hand over hand over hand. These are the different levels of the memory hierarchy. And the idea is they're going to keep the processor supplied with data and instructions. So it takes around about, as long as the processor is supplied, it can keep busy. If for one reason or another the memory pipeline stalls, and say there's a misprediction of where from the processor of where the next data is going to be required from, then in that case the eggs have to be brought all the way from the fridge, from main memory, and that's going to take around about 300 times as long. So if it took you 3 minutes to boil an egg, you're waiting 300 times 3 minutes, which is what, like 15 hours, 16 hours, something like that. So the processor, the person at the cooker, is standing twiddling their thumbs for 15 or 16 hours until they can get some more data to work with. So keeping the cores busy is really, really important and very difficult to do. So the result of this is that cache effects can easily dominate your performance. Typical programs have 95% of this, but the computer architects have spent a huge amount of time analyzing the behavior of programs and working out how to ensure that you get that you get good cache hit rates. Cache miss rates in typical programs are around about 5%. About 5% can be really important. You make a big difference. Let's take a look at, this by the way, I should add, don't take this from me as being like the gospel of how this stuff works, because it's much, much more complicated than this. I should have brought in the standard text on this, which I actually brought to this conference. If you want to understand computer architecture, you have to read a very, very thick book. What causes cache misses? Well, that's a really complicated story. They spend a lot of time on that. They spend a lot of time thinking about it. But the one I want to look at now in particular is failure of prefetching. So what do I mean by prefetching? Well, if we have a picture like this, and the processor at the top, I'm just going to look now at the level one cache because that makes life a bit simpler. There's in the case of the processor in the MacBook Pro, there's 2,000 what are called cache lines. A cache line is a unit of level one cache, also level two cache, which has to be replaced. Which is going to be written to memory or read from memory has to be read as a whole. So it's a very important unit. And there's 2,000 of those on the processor here. So the idea is that each one of these matches to some part of the memory. As the way in which these cache lines are loaded is very clever a lot of the time. So for example, if the processor notices that you're accessing data, or I guess instructions, but instructions are a little bit easier, I'm not talking about them here, in some systematic way, supposing, for example, you're stepping along an array, then it'll figure out, the prefetcher will be able to figure out where you're going next, and it can see, well, obviously, in this case, this program is stepping along the array, and I can pick the next element off, and so it can prefetch it and put it into a cache line ready to be used. That's going to really save a huge amount of time. So having predictable patterns of data access are really important for performance if you're worrying about cache misses. And another, if you don't have a predictable pattern, supposing you've got data dependent loads in which you never know because you're following a sequence of pointers, there's going to be no way of predicting where the next piece of data is going to be required from. So basically that's going to break the memory pipeline every time. So we'll see how this works out in a minute. But you can see it at least. In principle, how tough that's going to be. It's actually worse than I'm suggesting, and this is also something to take into account, because your memory is divided into pages, typically 4K, and each one of these, because the processor deals in virtual memory, which means a page address and a page offset, then in order to be able to access data at a virtual address, it's got to look up the page table. Now, looking at the page table is just another structure in memory. So you'd be adding the same problem on again for every single access to a virtual address. So they have this thing called when the processor wants to know where to look for the physical address that corresponds to a virtual address, it looks up something called a translation buffer, or a translation look-aside buffer, and that is a cache for the page table. And that will look up against the page index and the page offset. It'll give you back a physical address. The physical address can be used in the L1 cache, which is physically addressed, and it can also be used to find data from the memory. So you can see that going outside of the pages is going to get you another extra overhead. Even disordered data-dependent loads inside of a page is going to be expensive because you'll mess up the memory hierarchy, the level 1, level 2, level 3 caches. Going outside of a page will be worse still because you'll mess up the translation buffer as well. So I'm going to try to see whether or not I can actually illustrate all of this with a tiny demo. A few tiny demos. So I'm going to say, I've not done this before, so we'll see how it works. Demos and me we have a kind of uneasy relationship. I forgot to sacrifice a chicken this morning to the demo gods, so it might work and it might not. So the sample case I've chosen is just traversing a list, which is obviously order n. Because we're just going to step through a list. And we'll try this with linked lists and array lists. And we'll also mess with the data as well, because where the data is counts quite a lot as well. So there's four little demos. Let's look at the first two, the idea of the first two. I'm going to populate the array list with the code that you see there. It's really pretty straightforward. I'm just going to go through that. That's the array part of the array list. I'm going to put an integer reference into each element of the array list, and so we'll get that, and then that, and then that, and then that, and so on. So the idea of this is that we're going to have the data is going to be organized in a nicely sequential way. And we will hope that this will get us good performance, because if we think about what you can fit into those 64-byte cache lines, then you'll see that for the references, we're going to be able to, we can get 16 4-bit reference, 4-byte references. Nicely contiguous into a single cache line, and each integer takes 16 bytes, so you can get four of those in there. And what's more, prefetching should work perfectly, because this is going to be really straightforward. So we expect that to be really fast. So what I really wanted to do, was to run the test in parallel with the explanation. Start the test off and then run the explanation, and then give you the explanation of what was happening. That just screws the test up so badly. So I'll have to do them separately. The second one I'll do, and then we'll actually do them. I'm going to populate a linked list, but I'm going to do this. I'm going to hold the data the same. So I'm going to use those integers that were created by the first test, so that I can ensure that the green boxes on the right hand side are the same green boxes that the array list created, and that way the only thing that's going to change is going to be the the references themselves. And a linked list, a node of a linked list has three references in it. It's got a reference to the data, it's got a reference to the next node in the list, and it's got a reference to the previous node in the list as well. So as I add the elements onto it, you're going to get this pattern.
Yep.
Right. And when you want to traverse the linked list, well, now you can see that on the right-hand side, obviously, we've got the same situation. The integer objects are going to be contiguously arranged. On the left-hand side, the nodes of the array of the linked list are also going to be contiguously arranged, but they're very big. So this a linked list node has got contains 24 bytes, 12 bytes for the object header, and 4 bytes for each of the reference fields. So you can only get 2.5 nodes into a cache line. So prefetching should work fine, but the thing is you're going to have to do a lot more of it. Okay, so let's see how these two things work out, and then we'll go back and try if those work, then we'll go back and look at another two cases. But I need to mirror first of all. Oh right. So. This is what I was worried about. Right. Me and demos. Mirror displays. And right, so here is the test. I'm using JMH, but I have to say it's really a travesty. I mean, anybody who knows JMH, please look away now, because in order to make the test run fast enough to fit into a demo. I've really not used it properly. But never mind. So the idea is with the setup here is I'm just going to this code here sets up the array list, and I'm just putting some I'm putting some random integers in there just in order to make sure that doesn't give the JVM any chance to optimize that. And then I'm just going to iterate over it. And if you don't know JMH, you might think, well, what's going to happen to this? To the sum that's being returned here. Well, the answer is JMH has a clever Java benchmarking harness. One of the very many clever things that it does is have a thing called a black hole, so it can actually dispose of the value without costing you very much of an overhead, which is otherwise quite difficult to do. So I'm not going to go into detail about that now, just to say that effectively this code is what we're going to be benchmarking. It will take that one. This one really doesn't take very long because there isn't an awful lot to do, and we see that what we'll get here will be around about, as you can see, about 1.5 nanoseconds per operation, which is pretty good given the clock cycle on this is the third of a nanosecond. So the second thing I wanted to do was a linked list, but I was going to use the results of the I was going to use the data that had been set up by the first test. So for that, I'm going to create the linked list, and I'm going to add to that in the setup. I'm going to add the corresponding element on the array list. So it'll be array list dot get I. And now I want to use the linked list here. So you have to remember these numbers because I haven't written them down anywhere. That one was about roughly speaking 1.5 nanoseconds per operation. Let's see how long this one takes. The second one with the linked list that is organized. The extra cost here is just the fact that there's got to be that much more traffic on the bus because each node of the each element of the linked list requires you to load half. You're going to have to load a cache line on average for half of each. Sorry, one for every two data accesses, as against one for every 16 on the array list. So as you can see, there's a cost to this. Where it was about 1.5 before, this one has cost about we get, well, you see a huge error on there, but I'm asking you to ignore that because of just having to run in such a short time. But this is about typical. It's at least twice as much for the linked-list version. Okay, so that shows part of the problem. Let's go back and stop mirroring. I can mirror. Just leave this. Stop. And let's see the second half of the demo, where we're going to mess with the data. If you populate a linked list, and I've said naturally, but I mean, that's not a technical term. I'm just going to do what the code at the bottom of the slide says, which is just like, I'm just going to add elements to the linked list. So what's going to happen here is that it's going to alternately allocate the integer objects and the node objects. So you'll get this picture. That's an integer object that's been allocated, And now when a new node is going to be created, new elements to be added to the list, it creates a new node and it adds an integer on and so on. So that's how this works. And this is probably how you would use a linked list. This is more like how you would use a linked list in practice. And what happens when you try to traverse that? Well, the picture you'll get there is 64 bytes is two linked list nodes and one integer. So the brown box on the left-hand side. And the next time around, it'll be one linked list node, two integers, and a bit left over, which is going to be no use to anybody. So you can see that here what we've got is even more. This is going to be more expensive in terms of memory traffic on the memory bus, because now you don't have that nice situation that we had in the last example, where there were four integers for each cache line. Now you're going to have to make that many more. You're going to have to make that many more memory accesses. You're going to have to make that many more cache line nodes. so we're expecting that's going to be more expensive. And now I'm going to do something which makes linked lists look bad, but it's not really. That's the third demo. For the fourth one, I'm going to populate the linked list randomly. So instead of keeping the objects it's pointing to nicely organized, I'm just going to take them at random out of the array list. So the first one will be there, and the second one will be here, will be somewhere else, and the third one will be completely off the map, I hope. Yeah, and the fourth one will be somewhere else as well. So it's jumping about now in that list of integers that's been created by the array of integers that's been created by the first test, and we see here that now we've got the problem of the fact that each node is quite big, but also that I've made sure that we're going to have memory cache misses on the right hand side, and also because the array of integers is pretty big, we're also going to have translation buffer misses as well. So I've chosen the worst case and probably the most realistic one. So this actually brings together everything that's bad, and it makes linked list look worse even than it is, which is quite difficult because it's really pretty bad anyway. Because of course, what happens on the right-hand side there, that random access, so-called random access into different parts of memory, is something that could happen with any data structure. So let's see what that looks like on the when we run the tests. Mirror displays. Right. So for this one, the first one is pretty easy. I'm just going to create a new that's all I need to do here, I think. I'm just putting this is the natural one. I'm just going to add a new integer to the list each time. Now remember that the result for the last one was 4 at something, about 4 nanoseconds. Let's see what happens now. With the with nice prefetching. Prefetching will work okay, but the data structures don't fit into the cache lines very well. So we're going to be getting a lot more memory traffic. And now I have to. This is the part that I really wanted to run in parallel with the explanation, because I have to think of something to do. I can't juggle, and there isn't enough time to tell jokes. So I just have to hope. Well, you can see roughly what's happening there. Again, we have about double the time, don't we? So it's gone up from about 4 to about 8. And again, please excuse the error, the size of those errors. They're completely unacceptable and a real test. But actually, the real tests do show something like this. I just have to cut it down in terms of the time I've got. And now for the last one, I'm going to send it all over the place to see what really happens if the data is properly disorganized. And this will simulate data-dependent loads, which are a lot of our trouble. So I'll have to declare another variable, and I'll just randomize that as for access into the array. I'm just multiplying it by a large prime, and masking it against the length of the array. So it's not really random, of course, but it's kind of good enough. And now I'm going to and then I'll use what the ArrayList created, and I'll use that as an index into the values that the ArrayList created. Everybody follow that, okay? I'm sure you do. I'm sure it's harder for me than it is for you. Right. So let's see what happens with that one. Say that. And so we're up to 8 now. As you can see, I've organised things to get worse and worse. But this one is actually pretty realistic, I think. But it also takes the longest as well. So of course it takes the longest. So. The jokes and it was really pity. I was seriously hoping I could get across, but I was amazed. The size of the errors, which was quite large, when I run like this, just became enormous because running PowerPoint animations, which is what I was doing. Ah, there we are. It's finished sooner than I thought. 22. So that's a huge increase. If you compare that with what we had to start off with, which is 1.5 nanoseconds for each index. And all of these, and of course the point of this is, all of these are order one, or order n, sorry. They're all linear. In the computational complexity told you nothing about what was going to happen here. We're looking at a completely different dimension of expense, or a completely different contribution to the expense of operations, and one that you might well not think about in the ordinary way of things. And please don't think that this is a problem. It's kind of a problem with Java, a bit, because Java doesn't actually give you data structures are very heavily dependent on pointers. So, and pointers are obviously the menace here. So here's another thing that we got wrong for the yet another thing that we got wrong in the generics and collections book. We wrote there that we thought that arrays were a legacy data type in Java, and that was 10 years ago. So certainly the argument was very strong for arrays being a legacy data type. They don't fit with the generics typing scheme, and you don't have any of the very rich variety of operations you have with collections. They aren't extensible the way collections are. They're baked into the language in a way that gives no flexibility. So there's a lot of reasons why that was a reasonable thing to write, but you can see from this point of view that we may not be able to get rid of them yet. So I'll say one word more about that before I finish, which I almost have done, you'll be pleased to hear. One of the things I was worried about was how this would go for time, but it's not too bad. Because fundamentally, I've not got a lot further than what I've just told you about. I would like to say more about the different implementations of collections. You've seen about ArrayList and LinkedList. That's kind of a reasonable level of detail. Copy-on-write ArrayList is, it's an ArrayList, so actually that's quite good. Of course, if you have to... When you have to write to a copy-on-write ArrayList, well, you will at that point you're going to copy the entire array, I haven't really thought about what that's going to do to the elements of the array, whether or not that's actually going to mess up the coherence there. There is some progress with other collection frameworks. So the Eclipse collections have a fixed size list and an immutable list, and they treat memory better. And I'd actually like in a future version of this talk, I'm going to study those and take a look at how they work exactly. Oh, I forgot to say something about linked list, which probably is worth saying. Nobody really likes linked list very much because of its doubly linked structure, and because of what you saw there about its how memory hungry it is. So, Josh, I found this tweet from Josh a few years ago. it's not a popular data structure. There are much better ones. For example, ArrayDeck is a really good data structure which didn't appear until Java 6, and that behaves much better with memory. There are some interesting things in the sort of coming down the pike, as it were. There's a project called Object Layout. The idea of that is to it's quite limited in what it does, but it's meant to address exactly this problem. So it actually, Object Layout will allow you to create something like a C-style array of structs. Of course, it's fixed, and you don't get many of the operations that you can get with collections. Because I mean, this whole thing about being able to use pointers is exactly to allow a lot of flexibility in your data. So there's going to be a trade-off for that, at least until Valhalla comes along. The Java 9 has immutable collections which are slightly better. For example, the immutable map in Java 9 uses closed hashing rather than open hashing. So hash map in Java, hash map right up until now, manages overflow in the case of collisions by creating a linked data structure with all the problems I've talked about here. Well, it's not quite that bad with the immutable maps because instead of that, the overflow is managed by references within the bucket array rather than creating new nodes externally. So it won't be perfect by any means, but it will be better in that sort of sense. And I'd like to analyse that and benchmark that as well. And further down the line, there's Valhalla is coming. We don't know how much further down the line. I would like to say JDK 10, but I don't know that, and who knows when JDK 9 will come. So Valhalla, the idea of Valhalla is creation of value objects, which will actually start to smooth out the difference between objects and primitives, so that you will be able to have list structures that actually contain objects physically. So it'll be much easier to organize those contiguously. This is the major objective of that is exactly to get this kind of cache friendliness that I've been talking about. So I see that I've actually anticipated this slide by talking about maps as well, and I think I probably won't say much more. I won't say much more about those, except the Eclipse collections have these too. I haven't investigated the behaviour, the cache friendliness of any of these implementations, except I looked at immutable maps and I thought, oh, that's a good thing. That's definitely an improvement, but it will be nice to include those. Benchmarks of those in a future version of this talk. So the conclusion of sorts, as you can see, this is a work in progress, is, of course, I always have to say, performance doesn't matter. Mostly doesn't matter. Because when it does matter, it really matters. You can't ignore it. Every performance improvement naturally represents a trade-off, and so that's what we've got. All this huge amount of work that the architects put into ensuring that we would get the maximum possible throughput from the memory bus has a trade-off. It now means that data contiguity, data locality is suddenly a lot more important, and it's another thing that we really need to think about. Algorithm complexity is still important, though. You can't forget about whether your algorithm is order log n, n log n or order n squared. The difference in bubble sort and quick sort for a large data structure is a very big difference indeed. But you also, if you really want to understand performance, you've got to take into account all these other things as well. Monica's going to be talking later on today about garbage collection, I think. But garbage collection is a huge thing. And of course, garbage collection can have a big effect on data locality as well. I haven't covered that. I've only really had a chance to talk in the most basic way here. So I started the talk by saying it's not your father's complexity, but actually your father's complexity is still in there. It's just that complexity has just become an awful lot more complex than it used to be. Thank you.
Please remember to leave your feedback on our feedback box when you exit.
I guess I've used up the question time, haven't I?
And if you have some questions, Maurice will be happy to answer.
You can ask now or you can ask later, obviously. I'm going to be around for the rest of today, so some of tomorrow as well. Yeah. I haven't looked for situations where it performs better, so I don't know whether there are any. I mean, there's none of them come immediately to my mind. Of course, performance isn't everything. A lot of the time, you don't care about performance. And if you're dealing with if you've got a small data structure, and a relatively small number of elements, just a few hundred or a few thousand, then performance isn't going to matter too much there. And there may be situations, it'd be interesting to analyze to see whether we could actually find situations in which that ideal thing about adding and removing elements from the beginning performed better. In general, I mean, for the general case, yes, you're right, the performance is going to be very bad. The biggest problem, I haven't even begun to talk about the overhead. If you've got a large linked list, then it's using a lot of memory, and that means more GC. So GC, I didn't factor GC into this talk at all. In terms of performance, that may well be as bad as the effects I've been talking about here. So for large data structures, I think if you have a large data set and you care about performance, I think I can say you never want to use linked lists. But if either of those two things don't apply, then it also, of course, is an implementation of queue as well. So it might, it's got some useful functionality. No more questions. Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Maurice.